God is good, and all the time we are here gathered as the family of God for this wonderful Eucharistic celebration, as we commemorate this great day of the servant of God, Cardinal Michael Otunga. On behalf of the Office of the Chaplaincy, I welcome all of you, but in a special way, our bishop here with us, who is the guest and the main celebrant, to share in this wonderful moment of prayer, wonderful moment of nourishment.
Tumsifu Yesu Kristo. Thank God for allowing me to come today to celebrate Mass in memory of late Cardinal Otunga. I have been invited many times, but I've been escaping. So I think Pius Madden, who are with him in Eldoret, so he managed to persuade me. Thank you. I've been, not that I don't like, but sometimes at our age we try to avoid traveling. When you are young, you can travel. Now you reach an age when it's really, unless it's necessary. But today I managed, so I thank God. First, my interaction with late Cardinal Otunga is in 1982, when I was a deacon here. I participated in the breaking ground of the first building of choir. That time it was here. And the Cardinal and the seminarians, he participated in the breaking ground of the, it was library at that time, the first building. And I remember his vivid memory, how he was expressing the importance of education in a Messiah country. At that time, in all this area belonging to St. Thomas, they used to walk around here. There was no building, but at that time, 82, the breaking ground and the beginning of the present choir. So I remember him, what I've mentioned before. And also that was the culmination of his dedication to education. As you're aware, other missionaries spend most of their time in education and medical. All these two, the two ministries, was all to help our people to start from an education, to remove the ignorance, and also to stand firm in their lives. Most all the missionaries at that time worked for that. And Cardinal Otunga was the first African priest, spent time on that, even at the last minute. And he put more effort in this choir, as he was the chairman. The beginning, and that's what I really remember, good memory of this founding father of the choir. Then the second meeting with him was When I was appointed a bishop of Eldoret, so I asked him to be one of the consecrators at the consecration ceremony. So he accepted. After, as usual, Cardinal could not accept straight things. You tell him and he keeps quiet. So we think that he has forgotten. Then I was waiting. Then after some few minutes he said, yes, I've accepted. That was his nature. His nature was very slow to rush on things. But once he has accepted, he has accepted. And all I say is, let us pray to the Lord to help us. So I was also happy because I was very young and he came. Yeah, the main consecrator was Cardinal Tongo and himself and Bishop Njenga. Then from there, in 1992 of June, we walked with Cardinal as a bishop. First incident is 1992, when we experienced the first clashes of this country, tribal clashes. And we, the bishops, we all agreed we moved to the area being affected. And we moved here in solidarity with the suffering. And we see his attention to the suffering of people, his attention to the needy, when the shelter, to find the food. Just last month he celebrated the anniversary of Kaisa, who was a priest killed because of helping people like the bees. And the cardinal was so much affected. And when the IDBs were deceived, those from Kenya and also Bukia, the security went and said, we are taking you to a good place. Anyway, they were just removing, transferring their suffering to another worse suffering. So they brought the lorries. It was on Christmas night. Christmas. Then, from Minister Bukia, the IDBs were put on lorries, and the same night was transferred to Kiambu Stadium, and they were put there. So the next day, Cardinal found his people, I mean the people, in the stadium. And so he could not hold it. So he left his office and went to the stadium to be with solidarity with the activists. Then I remember the statement he made. He says, why do you people make difficulty for us the preaching of the word of God, the helping of people? Why are you doing this thing to our people? And he tried, he organized, he helped the people. You know, there was a men and children and women and all these things. This is the same first reading. St. Paul says we have to preach the word of God. We have to be evangelizers. But here the cardinal says, how do we evangelize when you have the security, the government bringing blocking our way of evangelization, our way of helping people? If it's a, you know. Then from 92 to 97, all these things, Cardinal was affected very much, as if he was the one being displaced. I remember many occasions in our meetings and other things, he cried one time, many occasions, because of the scene of the suffering of people. I remember Cardinal Otunga participated in the independence and all these things. So that was his now the worst experience. And he says, how can we help the people? The show is sign of works interest to the people. And he lowered himself to the lowest point of helping the suffering. This is the works I remember a lot, in solidarity with the bishops. The second is the young guys of Nairobi. We have many missionaries helping people, and he's the one that was more inviting and encouraging the missionaries to help people in slums areas and other places. It was his extension, and he always had time for each congregation. He invited with us. 8 years. One day I asked him, I had come for a celebration. He was opening a novitiate. I come to Romelo. He was like a father to me, sharing. So I asked him, Your Highness, do you know all these congregations in Nairobi? And then he said, yes, my Lord. He used to say, my Lord Bishop, I try to know them except the one they are hiding. So there are people who hide from us. Yaminis, how do you know this? No, I know all of them except the one who are trying to hide. They hide, they don't show themselves. But he is Cardinal, his eminence was always interested in every missionary work, every person, men and women. Why? Evangelization. That from there you are able to help the other people who are not near the Cardinal. He always takes interest. Sometime 1990 something, I cannot remember exactly, one of his priests had disappeared. The goodness, he died, and so I'm not afraid to say, because I know the fellow died. And I will not mention the name. So he disappeared. He was not in Kenya, he was outside, but he disappeared. So this priest, when he disappeared from a place of work in Europe or somewhere in Asia, he came and hide in Elder Diocese. But for me, I didn't know. So after Christmas, so I had gone to West Pokot. So coming back in the evening, I was told by the cook, His Eminence was here. He took lunch. Said, but I don't know. He never told me. So he came to the house, took lunch, and he rested as usual. He was driving, so he rested after lunch. So when I met him, I said, Your Eminence. Sorry, I was not around, I had gone to another function. He says, no, he's the same, my Lord, he's not. I was looking for a priest who disappeared. The only way from Nairobi, he would ask me, I will look for you. He says, no, I wanted personally. So he came, left Nairobi, early morning, and he had got information the priest was somewhere, and I didn't even know. Later on, after his visit, then I went to visit the priest, the same priest where he is. But my impression, what I saw is interest to each person. Imagine coming to look for him. That was my thing now. And anyway, he's following, because even if the priest had gone astray, he looked for him. Remind me of Jesus giving a parable of the lost sheep. And he managed, the priest came back to priesthood. He managed. It's his own way of simple way. I mean, if you imagine a cardinal coming to look for you all the way. So that was a very interesting life of His Eminence. He took interest. So it was giving us an example, the young bishops. And what I always remember him. If we are able to look for the lost one, not to rush for suspension, but to go is to look for the lost one, as he did. And And other priests, they go, the priests from Madras, they know, and the sisters, they know him. Always interest in helping the people. And things were very close to him. So anyway, we went to African Synod together, the first African Synod together. And he took interest of participating in the African Synod, social justice and that. By that time, he was a bit weak, but he struggled. We went together. If it was somebody else, I don't think we would have gone. But because of the interest of the church, the interest of African church, we went. But he was not strong medically, but he went. Then, in all the meetings of a Messiah, he always struggled to make sure that prayer has come up. There was a change. You know, when you speak of history, it's history. You cannot see it. You cannot, you know. And also, Cardinal has died. So there was some. academic, you have to say exactly what happened. Especially when the person has died. So you can talk about me when I've gone and died. But now when I'm still alive, you can excuse me, you can say later. No. It was a very hot issue. The beginning of prayer. It was not easy. So I'd like to tell the chancellors and others that it was not easy. So when you face challenges, it's not the first time. It is not the first time. So it was a hot issue in a Messiah meeting, and Cardinal again was affected because he saw that his vision is not coming up well. Very much affected. And he went aside and cried. Because he saw his vision is not coming up well. And we young bishops were not understanding. But that was the extreme of why Cardinal hold this place at his heart.
Your word, O Lord, is truth. Sanctify us in the truth.
At that time, Jesus told his disciples a parable. Can a blind man lead a blind man? Will they not both fall into a pit? A disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone, when he is fully taught, will be like his teacher. Why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, "Brother, let me take out the speck that is in your eye," when you yourself do not see the log that is in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take out the speck that is in your brother's eye.
Thank you. body and blood of our Lord Jesus, from the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room, but only say a word, and my soul shall be healed.
Lord, in love of Christ, bring us to life everlasting.
Solidarity with the poor.
Cardinal Otunga was very good in that. As we are this year of mercy, also are being invited to emulate the good examples of the servant of God.
Fund. The scholarship lecture and scholarship fund was founded in the year 2005. So we are now doing our 12th lecture. And I think this is really a very befitting. It was very right and is really in honor of the servant of God that we established a lecture. First of all, lecture clearly is what we do. We are used to lectures, like Father Mali was saying earlier on. So when we talk about lecture, we know what this is all about. But it is also, this is how we get to know him. We get to understand him. We get to understand his vision. We keep alive, you know, what he believed in. And so in that, you know, just the annual lecture that we have in honor of the servant of God, I think it's in itself a wonderful thing. But not only so that we can get to learn about his life, not only so we can know what he believed in, but also so that we can actually emulate him. We can make our lives, you know, follow his life with our lives, make our lives, align our lives to his. And I think that is really a great honor, you know, the greatest honor we can give to anyone. The second, of course, has to do with the fundraising, you know, because it is lecture and fundraising. And for the last 12 years, the university has been very faithful. Every year, we have this fundraising. So after understanding, you know, in the lecture, getting to know more about his life, then we also have, in practical terms, we get down to practice, to raise funds, because we know how very passionate the servant of God was. And we were reminded this morning by the celebrant, the bishop, that he really valued education. Education was very dear to him. So obviously, and he was concerned about the poor, about needy people. So what we have done as a university is put the two together. And we have said, let us provide quality education and give it to as many people as possible. Of course, in the process, there will be those who really desire an education, this beautiful quality education, but they cannot afford it. So let's pay particular attention to those and see what is it we can do to help them, you know, also get that kind of education. And you know, today in a special way, I was really thinking, the need is growing. Instead of decreasing, the need in terms of needy people only gets, it only grows. The government has decided, as you all know, to also post students to private universities, not only public universities. So in the past, it was like students who can afford to go to private universities can also afford to pay. Now it is like the government says, well, if anyone, if it is possible, we'll post you even to those private schools. Clearly, we are going to see a lot of more students who will be in need, needy students, even more than we have right now. Which obviously means we as a university have to start thinking, how do we, what is it we do, you know, to increase what we are able to offer in terms of scholarships, in terms of, you know, our support for the really needy students. And I think in future, of course, we have to think in terms of really moving beyond just annual, you know, scholarship, harambee, fundraising things. We have to think of really creative ways of doing that. But for now, I just want to say that the university did a good thing to start this. And for the last 12 years, about 15 million Kenya shillings has been spent on scholarships, giving scholarships to needy students. Now, even though that 15 million sounds like a lot of money, compared to how many more students really need, it's not a lot. So we still have to do a lot more, you know, to be able to meet the needs of people who really want to gain this education. Let me just say that, introduce this speaker, who is a member of the Congregation of Xaverian Brothers. He has a master's degree in religious studies, specializing in systematic theology. He has a doctorate in philosophy, having majored in history with specialization in ecclesial history and a cognate in sociology. He has also been working for causes of saints, the whole process of canonization of saints, since 2000, the year 2000. And he is a postulator, I know this is vocabulary, he is a postulator of several beatification causes in Kenya, Tanzania, Uganda, Rwanda, Ghana, the Philippines, and the United States. So clearly, he knows something about the process. And you know, we are all in the process. We are praying now for the beatification of Maurice Michael Cardinal Otunga and his canonization. Brother Reginald, you are highly welcome to address this congregation. Please let us welcome.
So 13 years have passed since the servant of God, Maurice Michael Otunga, passed on in the early hours of the morning of the 6th of September 2013 at Mater Hospital. Almost immediately and spontaneously, a general consensus developed among the faithful that a true man of God had entered eternal life. Because this opinion endured 5 years after, in early 2009, the Archdiocese of Nairobi initiated steps that would lead to the opening of his beatification and canonization process. From the 11th of November 2011, a diocesan inquiry took the testimony of 169 witnesses and put together thousands of unedited pages, as well as published writings, regarding or by the servant of God. At the end of the inquiry, on the 28th of September 2013, the thousands of pages that were gathered were immediately sent to the Holy See. These were formally received by the Congregation for Causes of Saints on the following 21st of November, thus opening what is known as the Roman phase of the beatification and canonization process of the servant of God, Maurice Michael Otunga. By the 9th of May 2014, the said congregation issued a decree which declared the validity of the diocesan inquiry that was held in the Archdiocese of Nairobi. With this, it became permissible to write the official biography of the servant of God, known in Latin as positio. During the last 2 years, I, along with the postulator of the cause, Dr. Valdery Hilliman, and the supervisor or relatore of the cause, the Capuchin priest Vincenzo Cristolo, have sorted the thousands of pages gathered by the diocesan inquiry in order to show that Cardinal Otunga practiced virtues to a heroic degree during his lifetime. The result was a draft for the four-part positio, consisting of more than 800 pages, all in A4, by the way, which were submitted to the Holy See on the 5th of May, 2016. These documents were restudied the middle of July of this year in order to see whether or not the structure that was allotted by the Holy See was followed, and it was. Our hope is that by the end of this year, the edited final draft of the positio would be published by the Holy See, so it can be reviewed by members of the Theological Commission, as well as the Congress of Bishops and Cardinals attached to the Congregation of God's Saints. The affirmative vote of both these bodies will pave the way for the declaration of Cardinal Otunga as venerable. A person declared venerable by the Church is someone who, during his or her lifetime, had not only practiced the life of virtues, something that all Christians are called to do, but more importantly, practiced these virtues in a heroic degree. The virtues in question are the three theological virtues of faith, hope, and charity, as well as the cardinal virtues of prudence, temperance, fortitude, and justice. Added to these are the evangelical counsels of chastity, poverty, and obedience, and finally, the virtue of humility. For a servant of God to be elevated to the honors of the altar, it must be proven in the positio that he or she had practiced these virtues in a heroic manner. But what does that mean, heroic? It means that the servant of God had lived the enumerated theological, cardinal, and supplementary virtues with constancy, with fidelity, and with joy, particularly during what is known as the terrible daily tediousness of life, and when exercising these virtues is almost impossible to fulfill. So how can we speak of the servant of God, Maurice Michael Otunga, as first a saint in mercy instead of a saint of mercy? Much of this can actually be seen in a very intimate writing on the part of the servant of God, which is included in the acts of the beatification process. As the members of the Historical Commission, along with the members of the tribunal, were scouring the archives of the Archdiocese of Nairobi, we were able to discover some of the unpublished writings of the servant of God, and one of them is a handwritten account of the servant of God about his own religion, about his own vocation. I found it quite interesting because if I were to date when this document was written, it looked like it was written around 1990, just when the servant of God was about to finish his term as Archbishop of Nairobi. And it seems that he was giving this talk to a group of priests during a retreat. In this talk, the servant of God recounted in his own simple way how he became a Christian. And later on, how, in his own words, he decided to forego of the honor of being the paramount chief in order to follow the vocation to the priesthood. He said, quote, "I do not understand why God chose me. I still see myself as this young African who just discovered the gospel without my own effort, but with God's effort. Were it not for God Himself, I would not have experienced His loving mercy." Most of us are very deeply aware that if there is any virtue that can be associated with the servant of God to the poor, it would be the virtue of humility. And in fact, this perhaps is the one virtue that everyone speaks about, whether it is spoken by his own brother bishops, or by members of the clergy, by consecrated persons, and by lay people who have witnessed his life. Witness after witness talks about the humility of the servant of God as if it was a humility that cannot be seen anymore. It was an image of the pastor of the prime diocese in the church in Kenya. Something that they see as difficult to associate with that position. It also became perplexing for us who were writing the biography, particularly because it seemed that the servant of God had everything prepared for him from the time of his birth. As witness number 148 had said in his deposition, from the time of his birth, his father, Chief Sudi, had already sensed that he will be the successor. Among the many, 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 and I'm using the exact words, many, many, many children of the paramount chief, he chose Otunga and gave him this name. Some of us might say that already the path is prepared for him. But what is incredibly interesting is that what we might see as a path that was prepared for Cardinal Otunga was something that he did not see was really for him. In his own words, he is surprised by the grace of God. He did not feel that he was better than others among the children of the paramount chief. When he was chosen, he took it as an obligation to accept whatever was to be given to him. As we were discussing this early aspect of the life of the servant of God, we, the writers of the Positio, were wondering whether or not perhaps this childlike attitude that was exhibited by the servant of God already predisposed him to also have a childlike attitude when the mercy of God came into his heart and led him to be baptized as a Christian. Something that was not necessarily planned by him, that something that just came and something that he felt he had to do.
After this is ashes. Three thousand, thank you. Cash of 2,000 and a pledge of 3,000. Out of your pledge in that term, my man Nyambana Joshua, Faculty of Education, class of 2011, pledge 3,000, cash of 2,000. And then this is 550 shillings. Trade bell services that in the cafeteria, 15,000. His family and himself, 10,000.
So this year we are going to give only the Cardinal Otunga Scholarship Award. And at this juncture, I would like that as you hear your name, you come. I hope all the beneficiaries are within here, because if you are not there and you have been awarded, we shall scrap the name off and we give it to the person who feels he or she will benefit from this. So as you are called, you come here and you receive your award. Pamela Alemurengi. Pamela to be followed by Ed Stella. then to be followed by Sandy Wilson Wamai. Sandy to be followed by Kibiagon Irene Jemchor. And Irene to be followed by Wangare Njeru Yunis. Wangare to be followed by Mutua Simon Muthoka. Simon to be followed by Niseta Wancha Njeru. Niseta to be followed by Otogo Vitalis Queen. And Otogo to be followed by Ocharo Francine. Ocharo to be followed by Hamoche Stephen Kinyantui. Kinyantui to be followed by Okelo Joseph Odhiambo. And Okelo to be followed by Kiprotich Philemon. And Kiprotich to be followed by Daniel Obote Emmanuel. Emmanuel to be followed by Gashie Peter Ndwati. And last but not least, Gitura Lilian Bonari. Gitura Lilian Bonari.
Let me take this opportunity to thank you all as one of the beneficiaries of Cardinal Otunga Scholarship Award 2016-2017. My name is Joseph Okelo, a third year student from the Faculty of Education, pursuing double bachelor degrees in education, biology and chemistry. I'm a third born from a family of seven, six boys and one girl. I was born in Utere Center, along with Victoria, in Homabay County, Super District. My late parents migrated to this center from our original home in order to generate income through fishing. My parents did not have proper educational background, hence their passion for wanting the best in education for their children. They therefore did all within their powers and means to see that we went to school. When I was in class 4, that is 2000, my father passed on, and I could not imagine how it was going to be with my mother left alone to cater for seven children. We had migrated to this place from our original homeland, and most of our relatives did not know us. We were like strangers to one another, and to relocate back there, as the culture where somebody dies, we have to go back and bury to the original homeland. In 2000, that one, when I was in class 6, my mother also passed on. Remember, we were in a new environment. All of us were minors, as none of us had finished schooling. There was no source of income, and only piece of land or property we were left with was a piece of land. I thank God for the unity of Christ developed among us as we could mobilize ourselves for responsibilities of looking for food, cooking, and going for shame, which we were not used to, but we mobilized ourselves with the situation. Being total orphans, we were divided among the relatives, such as seeing my brothers and sisters, I had to travel. Since I went back to stay with my grandmother, and our home was left with nobody. In 2004, I sat for my KCC exams in the primary school, and I managed to score 311 out of 500 marks. I was called to high school, which was the next level, but the question was who to take me. My uncle, who was a headmaster in a primary school, called me in his home and gave me hope. Although he was a man of family, but he was ready to sacrifice to pay my school fees in a condition of repeating class 8, that is 2008, and getting marks, which was to get admission in Vita High School, currently is a national school in Nairobi County. I was ready for everything, and even though it was the hard way, but it was the only way. I ask God for His power to be the source of everything and open for me the doors of heaven. Surprisingly, when result came, that is 2006, as you see, result came out, it was like a dream. I got one calling letter from one school, that was the Vita High School. From that time, I knew God is real and has our prayers. My father had no options but to take me to Vita High School, which he had promised. I started asking for support from friends, relatives, as well as so that I could buy some equipment for school, since it was a boarding school. I didn't mind what I was being given, even dishes I could take. Even though I did not meet all the requirements in boarding, but my uncle paid 26,000 Kenya shillings as fee for the whole year. I was taken there for admission. We were not bothered much since my brother who put me there was an alumni. In 2007, my uncle could not pay my school fees since his son was also joining high school. I was struck with the dilemma of either to drop out of school or to continue with school. My struggle with education became so tough and situations I could not bear it. No budget done for me, no fare, only to walk to and fro during opening and closing, and was a long distance. I could also go for the bathroom collecting for remnants of soaps of other students in order to be clean in school. I can remember one day as I was collecting the soap from the bathroom, one of the students saw and told me, "But that's bad manners. We are in high school." The only thing I said, I wish you could understand me. In Form 3, the fees are accumulated, but I could not be allowed to register for KCC exam, that is 2009, which made me repeat Form 3. In 2010, I decided to talk with my teacher, who was the Dean of Studies, in charge of registration to help me. He had agreed and he told me I have to pay 4,000 so that I'll be allowed to register for KCC. I talked with a friend whom we learned with and was working in Kuala's market, sent for me 4,000 to register. When result came, that is 2010, I could not take my certificate because the fee had accumulated up to 56,000, and I was told I could only get my certificate after clearing the balance. In 2011, a secondary school was started in our village, and I was requested to go and help as a PTA teacher. Later in 2013, the government principal was posted in that school, and I was told to be the acting principal. Later on, the BOG allowed me to construct a school canteen where I could sell sodas and mandazis whether should go through it as stars. I could not accumulate much because my aim was to get 56,000 in order to get my certificate from the school. In 2013, I met a friend of mine who advised me to fundraise in order to get money to reach my certificate. Then I started mobilizing students to help me do the fundraising. They later confirmed with their parents, and on 10th August 2013, I did my fundraising, which I managed to get 60,000, which I immediately took to get high school and got my documents. Through advice of my friend, I applied to be admitted in Kwea, that is 2013. After application from the document, I applied for loan, which they confirmed that I was going to be given 60,000. In September 2013, the loan confirmed that I was going to be given 60,000. In 2014, January, I joined Kwea after selling the canteen, which I constructed at 17,000 for the upkeeps as I joined Kwea. In March 2014, after joining Kwea, things changed because I had to cater for everything, that is food, rent, photocopying, and other expenses. And the money I came with got finished. That's January, when we were about to do exam around March, I could not pay for my rent. In fact, I was locked out of the house because I didn't pay my rent in time. This happened just during exams. Then two friends of mine came to my assistance and they paid for me the rent for that month. Later on, I applied for work study program in Kwea and I was given a chance to work. This helped me a lot because I could pay rent in time and meet a few of other expenses. Apart from the work study, the office of the chaplain also assisted me with food whenever I went. As time goes, I realized that Catholic University also offers scholarship, that is, Cardinal Otunga scholarship. I had applied and I was given. So special thanks for the founder of Otunga scholarship, which will only help me, not only help me, but many students who are struggling like me. It has been a lot of struggle, but through the Otunga scholarship award and the help loan which I survived on, I've been pressing on.
My name is Jenny Mamora. I'm from an alumni of this club, this great institution, and a 3 times recipient of this award. I was born in a single parent family of four, a single mother who is not employed. And so the challenges that come with that to support four children cannot be overstated. I was admitted in Kwea in August 2019 to pursue a Bachelor of Laws degree on account of my uncle who offered to pay my college fees. So I think Joseph and I share one thing in common, maybe an uncle supported us. But I did not know that I was going to be here for my first year before dropping out for lack of school fees. Since my uncle's business shut down, so paying fees was a bit of a challenge. So I went back home to be with my mother and I tried a business and tried something for my fees. In 2012, with savings from home and a hair blown, I came back and I was graduated into my second year. When I came back to school, I resolved that I'm not going to drop out again, but I'm going to finish at the rest and proceed to the next level of my studies. So I applied for the work study program, I was enrolled, and I applied for the scholarship, which I received, as I said, 3 times, that is a tune of 210,000. And up to this date, I'm greatly indebted for the assistance I received from this university and many individuals who believed in me. Invested in me. This scholarship made a central milestone that saw me graduate in October 2014 with a second class honors upper division, which was 3 points short of a first class. This statement is very close to my heart because I think, had I not dropped out, maybe I'd got in a first class and proceed to school of law. So I joined the Tuna School of Law last year in January, and yet again the challenge of school fees came into play. I applied for support from the Law Society of Kenya, and they gave me a full scholarship. There were 10 of us who received support from the SK, but I was the only one who was given a full scholarship for my studies there. Right now, I'm winding up on UPLED as the way the appointment of the new Chief Justice to admit us to the role of advocates. As I conclude, I want to say that it gives me immense pleasure to address you today on the occasion of our Cardinal Otunga lecture on scholarship fundraising in this year of mercy, and most importantly, on the fifth day after the canonization of Saint Teresa, whose life and works of mercy are replicating the life of the servant of God, Maurice Michael Cardinal Otunga. And my appeal to you, all of you here present, is that let us contribute generously for the benefit of our brothers and sisters who are in need. And to our beneficiaries, I would like to urge you not to forget where you come from. Support this school, even after when you finish from school, come back, give whatever you have. It's not about giving so much, but whatever amount you can give back, it comes from your heart, goes a long way to help someone. And I was thinking that when I saw the email inviting us for this award, I saw so many of us who were invited as alumni. I don't know how many are in the house. Maybe they should show us by waving their hands and standing from where they are. Alumni will pass the beneficiaries of this fund. Thank you. And I thought maybe the reason why maybe the rest did not turn up is because of commitments. So I wanted to request that the university should consider setting up an M-Pesa payday to support this course that can be running for the year. It doesn't have to be limited to September only. That is my request, and I thank you.
But clearly, this function or ceremony has been inspired by him, who is the way, the truth, and the life. To him, we should give glory and adore. And that is what has happened. The organizing committee led by Dr. George Demo, Dean of Students, acting on behalf of BBC Administration, Finance, and Planning, and then the team that made it possible for us to meet in this hall, have done a tremendous job under very challenging situations. In fact, I'll say unparalleled challenges to get us together to celebrate the works of mercy in the life of Maurice Michael Cardinal Otunga, whom we are extremely grateful, and we are extremely grateful to the committee. We have testimonies from Joseph Okello and Jemima Moragba. We'd like to acknowledge them for sharing their experiences as beneficiaries of the scholarship scheme. We thank them for this sharing because it confirms the value of this effort that continues to bring us to this ceremony almost every year. We had expected the CS to be here, but we need to acknowledge that he may not have been able to come for maybe one reason or the other, but he had actually shown considerable interest in this institution, and indeed in the private institutions in Kenya. VC was a bit late this morning for certain functions of ours because he was at a ceremony where students were assigned to Korea. So I think from next week we'll be seeing government-sponsored students. He should have made the announcement, but he's not here, so I'm acting for him. And we are getting 1,182 students from government. This occasion was graced by Brother Reginald Cruz. I think the sharing of works of mercy in the Cardinal's life will give all of us a lasting imprint in our hearts and minds, constantly reminding us of the benefits for the works of mercy. We are pleased that Brother Cruz will honor our invitation, and we will send our acknowledgement to him in writing for the honor that he has done to the Cardinal. In searching for the celebrant of the day, the Lord himself directed us to his lordship, the Right Reverend Cardinal Scorey, Bishop of the of Edward. We would like to thank his worship, and I know Brother Koma is here to extend our sincere appreciation to him for honoring our invitation, for celebrating the Mass, and for the homily, and then his own personal experiences that he shared with us. Finally, we thank all of you present and those unavoidably absent who have contributed in various ways towards the achievement of the committee's objectives and the success of the occasion. When you wake up in the morning, either by the Lord's internal clock within us or by the cock crowing, you know that it is prayer that is expressing its appreciation. Yedasi, Asantini San.
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The Lord be with you.
And
with your spirit. God bless and protect you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
There are the Lord. Thank you.